I'm Edwin Braun of Cebas Visual Technology, and I'm happy to have Andy Byrne with me here, and we are going to talk about his latest projects and what he did in the past and where he is at right now. So go ahead, tell us something about you, Andy.
Hey guys, hey Edwin. Andy Byrne. I've been a visual effects industry since 2006, so been doing it quite a while. So been doing effects exclusively for at least 10 years. Kind of had the first 2 years of, you know, doing paying my dues, doing the match moving and roto all that. So I've been doing it a while. Been in LA for about 10 years as well, maybe about 11 or so. Feels like 30.
Where do you originally come from?
Funny story is, I'm from Santa Maria. My wife and I are both from Santa Maria, which is where Cafe FX was at. At least their main hub. All local guys up there that started that company, and I got started up there, and started match moving, working for free. Started staying late, figuring out what needed to be done in effects and just kind of learning it and doing it. I don't know if that flies anymore these days. But,
I have no idea either.
I will say, 11, 12 years ago, wherever it was, when I started, I imagine it definitely was cheaper to live in LA, but not as cheap as it was to live in Santa Maria. So I think if you're starting out in LA, you definitely want to get paid something, because otherwise you're just not going to be eating.
So. Yeah, that's right. So you moved to LA then 10 years ago, you said, right?
Yeah, I moved in 2008 or so. Cafe was just going through some trouble, and luckily, I was one of the times they were getting in trouble, and I was lucky enough not to lose my job, but they wanted to kind of put me back into tracking and match moving. Mm-hmm. I'd rather just not have a job. I was done with it, So
okay, I can.
I made the move. I just did a random digital dimension, random email website portal, job portal opening, not even thinking it's going to hit. And they emailed me right away, drove down here. It's about three and a half hours of south of where I'm from. So I just hopped in my truck and came down here, interviewed, took it right away, probably for a lot less money than I should have. I didn't know any better. So that's kind of how then the ball just kept going from there. And it's just been kind of a huge snowball blur of working for the last decade or so down here.
Yeah. I know we had you interviewed in 2015. We did this text interview on our webpage. And there you already had done or were involved in some amazing things, like for in the game industry. You did something for the very first Destiny franchise.
Oh, yeah. That was 2013 or so. Yeah. And you know what's funny, or kind of what sucks about it is that I don't know if that thing ever got released. So yeah. I only have what I took, some of the semifinal comps, remembering that. So I don't think it ever got put out, and it looked great. So I'm not sure what happened with it, but I think it's some with Microsoft and whatever. But
yeah. So you worked in the game industry for some time.
No, that was actually, I've never worked in game industry. That was actually cinematic.
Just cinematics. Okay.
Yeah. And that was for Prologue Films, and they are mainly known for just titles, opening title sequences and such. I forget the owner's name, but he's really talented guy, kind of a known guy, but, that was kind of a new thing for them, like a big job. So, what was cool about it was just a bunch of buddies got hired, and it was fun. We made some good stuff that no one ever got to saw or never got to see. So,
okay, that happens sometimes in this industry, especially when you're dealing with movies and stuff, things get just cut out of the final shot sometimes. Yeah. So one more thing, how did you end up from 2D when you say rotoscoping is where you started? How did you end up in 3D then? You can't do that overnight, right? Or
you know what? It was I actually got started in tracking, and I was terrible at it, of course. And so I was kind of doing both at the same time in parallel, because it was just kind of like, at least back then and with the group of guys we were with, mm-hmm. It was just kind of like, oh, this guy's an intern, have him do all the stuff we don't want to do. Yeah. They actually did have a really, really talented tracker there, though. Kevin Hoppe was his name. And he kind of took me under his wing, or was forced to, and kind of taught me everything about 3D. I mean, I went to college for 3D, a university in Fullerton. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you learn, this was before Noman was big or anything like that. No. So kind of went there and learned some basics, thought I knew what I wanted to do, modeling or animation, right? That's all they kind of teach you.
Yeah.
And I thought I knew something. And as soon as you start that job, you realize you don't know anything.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was lucky enough to get in there. I ended up leaving school because it would have taken me, I think it was something like 2 years to finish another semester of classes, because it was so impacted, so crowded. So I actually moved back home in hopes of getting that internship, because I knew people at Cafe FX. And I did some jobs, I bartended, and it's the bar that like all the Cafe FX guys would go into. And I started buying them drinks. And sure enough, the VFX soup comes in and says, hey, D, what do you know about match moving? I said nothing. Well, you're going to learn it, so you can start Monday for free. So, I mean, I was up the wall, so excited. You know, I mean, can you imagine? You know, I thought I was going to fail, and you know, this is going to be my life now, bartending. And I, you know, so I was very, very lucky. I would recommend that, though. You know, buy your supervisor's drinks.
Okay, that's a tip. So Cafe FX, I know them because we had, that is so long ago, I can't even remember. Yeah. I even visited their offices down there, and I think that was a project with Blade Trinity, I think.
Oh, probably. That was a little bit before me, but yeah, a lot of friends, that was a big one for them they worked on, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, I know them. So that was a long time ago, but they no longer are active, right? They're there.
No, you know, a couple of guys have a little outfit up there. It's mm-hmm. called the Resistance, mm-hmm. And I've done some work with them, and they're kind of doing the same thing. You know, just jobs come in, do them, not chasing them down, kind of thing. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, you do it for so long, and especially, I was just saying this, you're living in LA, it's you get this kind of like shotgun of, you might get 15, 20 years experience in 10-year period of time of just, it's not necessarily getting better and better, but just seeing how things work and seeing this whole industry change so quickly. So I think everyone's a little burnt.
Okay, let's come back to your history. So after Cafe FX, where did you end up then, or how was your path?
Oh man, so my career, I think I've been at a studio that's gone through the changes. I think I've been at six different studios that were shutting down mm-hmm. at that time. They were shutting down, so I went to Dimension within 3 months. Same thing as Cafe. Money's not coming in, and it's getting tight, so I jumped ship again. I went Scanline, was there for a while in 2012. That was a big, big TP movie.
Yep.
In my eyes, saved that movie.
Yeah.
From there, oh man, I've been a lot of places, but I think I went to one more small shop, but back then, so this had to be 2009. Back then it was kind of known, if you want to do the heavy, heavy effects, you know, before 2012, mm-hmm. If you want to do the heavy, heavy effects, you have to go to DD, Sony, or R&H, you know. We called it the triangle, yeah. company. If you got into one, then you're just going to be in this circle and just go, you know, to each one every six months or something.
Yeah.
So I got into this company called Asylum that was around for a long time.
Yeah.
They shut down. And then I went to DD, mm-hmm. and Sony, back to DD, R&H, and after that, Pixo, went to Pixomondo.
Mm-hmm.
And so by the time I went to Pixomondo on Star Trek Into the Darkness, I think it's called, I was, you know, all Houdini for the last 2-3 years. Mm-hmm. Kind of, you know, I kind of had to relearn all that stuff and kind of, I haven't touched Max or anything for a handful of years. Going into Pixomondo, very heavy Max and TP, I just remember thinking like, oh my gosh, like you forgot, you know, when you're working with 100 other effects people, and then you go back to what your roots are of, you know, just you and two other effects guys maybe. And I mean, I just remember sweating, like, I can't do this. I don't remember this stuff. But I mean, it was like a bicycle. It is within 2-3 days, just remembered everything. And then that was also when the big, I think TP5 came out.
Yeah.
Like when Bullet was first introduced. And I remember just it making me so mad because how easy things were. Like, you know, not to do things in TV, how to, you know, I just remember Volume Breaker and all that stuff that I remember being, it was just so much easier than TPs. And then you remember, like, this is why these companies are able to have 2-3 really solid effects guys, because they have this right tool here and they can do everything right here. Mm-hmm. So that's, ever since then, you know, I've been forced every now and then to kind of hop in Houdini or whatever. But man, I fight it tooth and nail. those 3 or 4 years I used Houdini exclusively probably were the most unhappy I was ever at a job. Just so boring. Just relying on 100 or 30 other effects people. It's just not for me. And look, I mean, obviously there's some great artists out there, and these huge companies do some great work, you know. But I just, you know, I think every artist kind of goes through that, like realizing what kind of artist do you want to be? Do you want to just make a cash and then hand it off to people? Or do you actually want to someone, your producer or VFX, to come and say, this is your shot, you have to do all of it? And that's kind of what I like to do. So that's kind of, I realized, it took a handful of years to realize that.
Yeah. And that was actually always our idea. We always wanted to create a tool that gives you the power of 100 people team so that you as one person can do what the big guys can do. And we saw that in parts happening when 2012 was done. Effects guys at Uncharted, that was Uncharted,
right.
Did, and Pixomondo. There were a lot of companies involved in 2012. So, but I remember the guys at Uncharted, they did amazing stuff. We couldn't believe what they pulled off. So did the big guys. So did the big studios like ILM, for example. They just couldn't believe that they could pull off these visual effects with such a small team. And that just speaks to the tools we had at that time.
It's true. You know, I remember specifically that time we came down and we had a lot of friends that worked with these bigger studios like DD and R&H and such. And you know, I had just started that job at Scanline, you know, still so green. And, you know, on the weekends, we meet up with all these guys, and they're all effects soups and everything, these bigger companies. And they're saying, like, I think we lost this whole sequence, this 2012 movie, to this company no one even knows who they are. And I'm just laughing because, you know, Uncharted, like, they had a pretty big history with Cafe as well, you know, Mark and Volker. So I was just sitting there laughing and so happy to be, you know, working in a Max environment and just being like, I remember just being proud, you know?
So, I think the ease of use and flexibility we have in Thinking Particles is a good advantage. And then I personally like 3D Studio Max a lot. I think 3D Studio Max is an amazing tool. And if you know how it works, if you can create an environment, a workflow around it, you can really pull off amazing things.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I feel like it's, I mean, what was that, max 8, 7 or 8 that started at a cafe. I mean, this is back when, you couldn't even get cameras over from Maya to Max. I remember we had to export to XSI and then do that to Max. I mean, and you're looking at it now, I mean, just in the last 4 versions or so, it's really gone up, you know, and I really think I'm curious what's going to happen, you know, with Autodesk. I think everyone's a little curious, you know, I think that's always been kind of the rumor. Is it just going to be one big package or what? But I love Max. And I just had an opportunity to work. I was forced to work in Maya. It hasn't changed a bit. And I mean, at least for effects, which is good because I just remember you do the same expressions for whatever. But it's also terrible. I mean, I just can't believe nothing's changed. And
it's the different philosophies. In Maya, you need a team to handle one product. In Max, you do all on your own. So
yeah.
Max is really for the one-man fighter, and he can actually do a lot there where you would need in other environments. You just need multiple people to do one thing.
Absolutely. I'm a huge fan of it, and. I think I'm at the point now in my career where I just say, like, you know what? Just tell me what you need. Don't worry about what I'm using. Yeah. I'll make it look good. And I mean, especially now, I mean, when Alembic became kind of the norm and a VDV, I mean, you can hop around in anything if you know, the studio, like making clouds or whatever, making this and they do it in this, and then you can give them a VDV and whatever, let them render if they want to.
Where are you now?
So I've been on my own again for the last 2 years, or coming up on 2 years, and I have kind of the regular people that I usually work for, and then I'll get just by word of mouth commercial studios or TV or whatever will kind of hear about me through a producer or a friend that worked with me in the past, and I'll just get an email and then bid the job out and do it that way. So I'm pretty lucky. I've worked hard on build up reputation of being fast and making it good, you know, but I think, you know, there's a little bit of argument there, like, you know, fast. Someone, effects soup once told me fast isn't always the best. And I said, yes, but fast gets you talking right away instead of waiting for a week on a sim or something. So that's how I like to work. I like to work fast, show stuff right away, and we can tweak it. I'll use up-res stuff and, you know, work on your dynamics and whatever. I mean, that's kind of, you know, second nature effects guy. You know, we know how to do that. I just want to get the feedback, you know, so we get stuff going and everyone makes money, you know. So I've been doing that. I work a lot with a company in Atlanta called Crafty Apes. Mm-hmm. Again, they're old cafe guys, orphanage guys. They do a lot of comp work. They have an LA office here. Their main hub's in Atlanta, New York. I work with a lot of commercial houses, a lot that I've never even heard of, and I feel like there's a new one every day. So.
Yeah.
But I feel like commercials are fun just because no one's really expecting Transformers, you know, like amazing effects. So it's usually pretty easy and always kind of the same stuff. We need dust, we need rain, we need, or what's might be fun, oh, we need this wall to blow up or something. The movie stuff, you know, like working for Crafty, that's kind of more fun for me because that's, I guess, where we got started working on movies, and you just kind of forget. You do get a little more time to where you can actually really think about something, how you want to do it and set it up. And so I'm lucky enough to kind of get this balance every now and then, like a movie and then, you know, 3 months of grinding commercials and then a movie, you know.
Okay. So then I usually ask this in every single interview. What's your best shot you really loved working on, and what's your most terrible experience you had so far? Start with the best one you really liked, you really enjoyed working on.
Well, I'm going to add a little tangent to it. My favorite shot, aren't the best ones. Okay. But my favorite shots are this movie that just came out, and I haven't seen it yet, but it's like a dark comedy where these girls are throwing up. And, you know, one of my dreams, I always wanted to work on a movie like Silent Hill, like really dark and gory. I never get that opportunity. It's just never come my way. So doing puke was the thing. And I just did that.
Fuck those mother.
I'm in.
Prom night!
I'm ready. You look beautiful.
I used to hold that girl in the palm of my hand.
Kayla's becoming a woman. You're going to have to deal with that.
Thanks. Was looking for that.
I'm a team player.
It wasn't like the best stuff. It was, you know, quick.
How did you do puke? That sounds interesting. Now you have to tell me.
It's a good segue. It was, I used TP for everything.
Okay. You
know, and I said it was Houdini. No, I'm just joking. It was, I used TP, SBH, you know, it's funny because I switched between the new solvers. And the chunkiest one, I think the first version was the best. You know, for the kind of puke they wanted. So,
okay, great. So you had the color right, I guess, the chunks right?
Yeah, I rendered
the volume.
Chipped, and yeah, it was just a lot of subsurface and chunkiness. And then it used wet matte stuff. That was great. That was a cool new addition. That was actually the first time where I got a chance to really kind of use it in production. Yeah. And it worked awesome. So the best experience, though, I would say, is ironically, is at Digital Domain, and it was for a movie called Real Steel. Mm-hmm. It was like the boxing robot movie with Hugh Jackman. And the only reason that's kind of the first job where I was starting to learn Houdini, and it wasn't necessarily fun because I was learning, and talk about a learning curve with that program, but it was 10 months, and we didn't work any overtime, and everyone was happy with it. Everyone, you know, the DD, I remember they said it was the first profitable movie they worked on in, like, years.
Yeah.
So everyone was, you know, no egos, everyone's happy. So that was probably the best experience. The effects weren't anything to write home about. It was just, like, sparks and things like that. Mm-hmm. But the worst experience... Man, I have a lot of them, but...
okay, spit it out.
there's a reason why I work at home now, so... I have a hard time, you know, I don't ever really feel... Like, if I need to work OT or overtime, I will, like, if I feel I need to. And unfortunately, you know, a lot of producers and companies just don't think that's a good judgment. Like, they have to decide if you need to work all weekend or till midnight. And, I don't want to single anyone out, but commercials get a little grinding, and I don't think it's anyone's fault. I mean, everyone's doing their job. Budgets are slim and deadlines are crazy. So, yeah, it's but I will say the last in-house studio job I did was at a commercial house, and I did that for a year and a half or so, and that's what made me just think, like, I can't do this anymore. Like, I'm just going to go work at home, work for my buddies, work for people I trust. And, so that's kind of where I'm at now. Led me here.
Yeah, I can understand that. And I've seen in several productions and studios some things where I say, okay, that's strange. That's really strange how they handle it. But it's a crazy industry. They have to create more and more visual effects in a movie, and yeah, it's just a crazy task. But it only goes on for that long, and then usually you get some time off, I hope.
I'll tell you one, since I think their the hydraulics was I went in there to kind of bring TP in there after Asylum. And what year this was, 2010 or something. And I knew all the stories about hydraulics. You just work and work and work. They have so much work. And So they were all Maya, so I brought in Max, and that was something new for me. I was happy to do it and, you know, to promote all this stuff. And, you know, set it up. I think we got Final Render in there, too. And after it was all set up, I gave everyone a little bit of tutorials on TP. And then after the honeymoon stage ended about a week after that, then you started working 15-hour days, 18-hour days, coming in Saturday and Sunday. And I just got to a point like, oh, I'm going to hit up my friend at Digital Domain, and that's where I went, the real steel. But I just remember they said they were trying to get me to stay.
Yeah.
And I said, no, no. And then they start offering you stuff, which is also the first ever I've ever seen that. I mean, other than like money, they're like offer me gift cards and stuff at restaurants and stuff. It was it's something like work, if you work for the next like 90 days straight, you know, we'll give you a bonus. And I just said, no, that sounds awful. But I think people did it, you know, they worked, they grinded it out. So
it's, yeah, it has to be balanced, and you have to be in the mood for it and go through with it, and then all is fine as long as you're not really sacrificing and make it torture for yourself,
right?
Because then it's problematic, I think.
So, I think, you know, it takes a couple of years to figure that out. You know, if I mean, man, even grinding for a year, of course I'm older now, but I mean, back then I was just happy to work on cool stuff. You know, I would put up with, you know, sleepless nights and everything just to say I worked on this. And I think that kind of goes away a little bit, but I can't, you know, maybe it's a little biased just because the industry's so changed now and everything's so fast. Everyone wants, you know, quality and the cheapest and the fastest, you know.
Yeah.
So it's always been that way, but what starts it is the budgets start doing this, you know. So that starts at the top and just everyone, you know, everyone below just gets affected. So
yeah. Let's talk about some effects and how you could solve them or realize them with TP. Does anything come to your mind that was fun doing, where you said, okay, that worked, that's surprising, or that's cool, or did everything work as you expected? I guess not. You usually...
You know what? I'm a pretty big fan of it. I don't have much to say about it, you know, negative-wise. I mean, I was telling Cedar about this, you know, like Joe Scar, you know, he was the first TP guy I met, luckily, at Cafe, working on Spider-Man 3. That's where I first got introduced to it. And I think that was like TP1 or TP1.5 or something. And it was when the interface was, you know, all cubes.
Yeah.
You remember this?
Yeah.
Straight lines. And,
yeah.
And of course, Riff. And, ever since then, what was I saying? So, but seeing Joe, you know, and how he worked and his methodologies, and I mean, even still, he'll put out a tutorial and you're just like, oh my gosh, like, this guy's a brain, you know? And I've taken tons of tips from him over the years and what he puts out. And, I've never been a super technical effects guy. I just kind of do what I know. I feel like I know TP very well nowadays, and I just know what it's going to do. If, you know, I have a character running and, you know, I want, you know, foot dust or something simple. Mm-hmm. I make emitters, and yeah, it's like the easiest thing to set up now. You know, it's like, oh, you know, and of course there's three or four different ways you can do it.
Yeah.
I get lazy and I do, you know, I'll put a locator on their feet and do a distance condition, you know, which has been around since TP's been around. And I mean, the thing with that, it's, you know, it's built in, you know, so compared to something like Houdini where you have to actually build that distance node. And that's what drives me nuts about it. You know, why can't they wrap this up for poor users like me when you get forced to use Houdini? And make it so much easier, like, this is your distance node, this is your random node, and then if you want to dive into it, you can, or whatever. I like to keep it simple first, you know. I forget who taught me that, or if it's just a handful of people or companies I work with, I like to do the easiest thing first and see, for lack of a better term, see if you get away with it, or see if it, you know, see if it just works or it looks good. And if it doesn't, then you go in there and start changing things. But yeah, I mean, that distance node, I mean, I've used it for everything. For Chris, another thing, like feet stepping on the ground. It was like this ice monster, is this commercial. And it's this big ice monster, and every step he took, crystals had to grow out. And then and it kind of freezes. So then as he lifts it, then it has to break.
Yeah.
I mean, it's pretty, it's semi-complicated to, wrap your head around. So I just did. I'm like, well, what if I do what I usually do for, like, dust and all this stuff? And then, put it into another condition or group and turn it into volume breaker and put it in bullet or, shape collision or whatever. Totally works. So
that's how it should be. That's also your know-how you get over the years. So that's your edge you have in the industry, is because you have been so long in there. You have your ways to do things, and I expect you also have some black boxes or saved some setups that you can easily just drag and drop in and start from there.
Yeah,
which is a huge advantage, and we always wanted to offer these functionality as well. This is why we have these black boxes where you can save and merge them and create your own library of effects you usually do.
Oh, absolutely. It's, greater than or equal to, I mean, something simple as that. I mean, plug your group into that and throw in a float or a random based on age. I mean, it's so powerful what you can just do with something simple as that. And, I mean, again, just hopping in other programs, I mean, it's a little tricky to do that. Yeah. So I'm forever grateful for making my job easier, or easier than it can be. Yeah. Joe Patrick Schuler is another guy at Pixo. That guy was a brain. Justin Mitchell, I think he might still be at Scanlan. I'm not sure. I met him at Scanlan, but he was a big digital dimension guy. Those are probably the key guys that I learned a lot from, either personally or just from what they put out. I actually just bought Joe's cutting tool. He's like, hey man, what's going on? So, yeah, I love it though. Max TP, man, it's I say, man, there's not much I can't do without that combo. And if I get, every now and then I get this, an email or something about a, commercial job or something with a company I haven't worked with before. And to get them kind of comfortable with me working remotely, or, I call it local remote since I'm still here in LA. I usually do like a meet and greet, and come in there and say, talk to them, introduce myself. And it's usually, can you do this? Are you comfortable doing lightning, rain or explosions or whatever? I say, just tell me what you want. I can do it. I'm completely comfortable doing it. I feel like this day and age, or this long in my career, there's not much you haven't seen.
Yeah.
unless you're in Vancouver at big studios and Marvel's trying to come up with some new effect no one's seen before.
No.
Not that you can't just do that as well. You can, if you get a solid effects guy, you can pretty much do whatever you want. So
what is your most favorite operator besides the distance operator, which I already heard, but is there any other operator you really like or think is cool? Or
I'm actually using text map noise is cool.
That's the new one we had in 6.6.
That's very cool. The Trailborn has saved my butt many times. Awesome for like jet contrails and such,
Yep.
Flow, man, I just keep, ever since that came out, I thought, I had to do blood, black goo kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And it's just worked, man. I mean, I remember getting put on the show. It was the opening title, and I wasn't on the job. I was on a different one. And a couple of guys were trying to do stuff in RealFlow. Mm-hmm. I've never, for some reason, I just never learned RealFlow over the years. I thought I would, but just never got around to it. But I just always heard it, it's kind of painstaking to go from one package to another, blah, blah, blah. That's kind of why I never really dealt with it. But anyways, they were having trouble, and deadline was coming up, so I just said, well, I'm looking at it and kind of what they want. And I said, why don't we just try this in flow? You know, it's stuff that needs to creep down, you know, a pillar that needs to be goopy. Let's try it, you know? So why do we need to, you know, sim this? We can just do particles and have flow kind of do its thing. And again, it was awesome. So now it kind of shot myself in the foot because now it's due in 4 days. So it worked straight.
Yeah.
But it's very cool. I'm not sure if I sent it to you. I'll send it to you. It's there's one shot where it's like these snakes. There's a muddy water surface, mm-hmm. and this big sheet of black goo comes in. And it kind of has these fingers in it, and so I got tubes on splines, animated them, and used those as emitters. Of course, with a collision on the surface, and kind of modeled just some proxy kind of chunks on the surface for the water that was in the plate, and. It was funny because it started bunching up so much, it almost kind of started airing out, mm-hmm. like the mesh part. So what would kind of be more, bad for a sim or wouldn't work in a shot, it actually worked because it gave like this, nemesis looking, very daunting look to it, like it's bubbling and it's alive, which they loved. So I was like, hey, win.
Yeah, that's cool. That's good to hear. Oh, yeah, this fluid thing, this gives us a headache. You see it with every subscription drop. We have a new solver. You see that. You can select them.
Yeah.
Because we are never happy with it. And with our latest release, the drop 6.6, we stabilize the SPH even more. So it's right now, we think, the most stable SPH you can get on the market.
All right.
It's so stable. You can fill a container now. And keep in mind, we are SPH, so everything is based on particles, and it's not a flip solver. So, and for the particle-based fluid simulation, it's what we think really stable now. So we are now slowly being happy with it. There might be one more iteration coming, but I think we have it really stable now. You can do really amazing stuff with it.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think every fluid solver starts with, or, you know, before Flip came out, it was all SPH, you know, so it was, I think it was a lot of people fighting the solver, trying to, you know, make it look like different things. But I've always liked that actually better of, having control of your particles and, you know, especially in flow where you can just sit there, turn off, edit on fly, and then do updates and it just updates because it's usually very light, you know, especially if you're doing like something like blood and say if you have to do like 30 different blood squibs.
Yeah.
I mean, those aren't heavy at all. So you can actually have it meshed and then just update and change your seed or turbulence. And I love it. You know, and the AP field stuff's been great too for collisions and that's been a lot better. And then of course, you know, like TP bread and butter, the dynamics, the rigid body stuff, just, man, I just haven't seen anything come close to the ease of use and get, you know, first pass, just put down a fractured cube, have it break again and again, you know, two different levels of breaking, that it, and it's so stable. So it's, this last job I had to do, this poor guy was doing fracturing stuff in Houdini, and I think it turned out he was a max guy, and me and him were joking. He goes, man, we just need some TP in here. Yelling over the desks, and I was just, because he heard I was a big max guy, and he's just laughing. He's a little bit younger, and I got a kick out of it. I go, yeah, you're not wrong.
Okay, so we are reaching already our 40 minutes. Wow, that went really fast, this interview. Let's just wrap it easy up. And do you have anything you wish we would add to TP? Anything you want to mention from the industry side?
Yeah, I mean, I just watched the one with Joel. And by the way, kudos to Joel. Your Plexus thing is great. I learned a lot from that too, and have used that.
Yeah, that's
awesome. And I would say, like what he said, and I've said it a long time too, Maya. If you get it, if you guys could get into Maya somehow. I know it's a pain in the ass, but
yeah, it is. But you're right. You're not the only one. So we have it on the list of the things we want to do.
Yeah.
But it's other
everything else. I think you guys are doing great. And if you when you guys switched to subscription, it was, you know, I think it and you know, it enticed companies to buy it more because it's you know, it's like half the price, and then you get all these, you get what, 2 to 3 to 4 updates a year. I mean, I love it. So it's to me, it makes sense. I just, you know, like I said, I don't have much negative reviews about TP. It's done me wonders over the years, and I'm going to continue to use it, you know, for as long as I can. As far as, you know, anyone wants to get into this industry, I'd first shake them. I'd say, you know, like, yeah, I mean, there's tons of work. There's so much work. And you don't have to go to the big companies. You might, you know, to get started, who knows. But, you know, I will say learn everything. I feel like that's kind of gone away over the years. And when I got started, everyone... Specs guys, when I got started, you had to learn cloth, hair, everything, and render your own stuff. And, you know, that to me, I'm so grateful I learned all that stuff because you might get a really good effects guy, but he doesn't know how to render anything, which is strange to me. But I would say learn everything. You know, what I've noticed, Max guys have dabbled in other packages, and they take either they like this about that, hate this about this, but Max TV is always the core, you know, and that's kind of what my experience has been. I haven't noticed much guys or girls that start in this package that isn't Max TP and branch out. You know, they stick in that, and I think that's such a mistake because you learn so many other things about how these packages work, and you should know how these other packages work, because a lot of times you're exporting stuff anyways for, you know, lighters or, you know, for comping, anything. So that would be my advice. And then, just put on a good face and do your best.
Cool. Okay. Okay. Thank you so much. Was really nice talking to you. Very interesting stuff. And I wish you the best.
All right, Edwin. See
you. Okay, goodbye.
Bye.